Sonny's death leaves his younger brother, Michael, as the most viable option to take the helm of the Corleone family. If Vito's quiet authority and Sonny's careless impulsiveness occupy opposite ends of the spectrum of masculinity presented in the film, Michael's masculinity lies squarely in the middle. He is intelligent and collected but unforgiving. He has the tact of his father and the audacity of his brother. A telling difference between Sonny and Michael's body language is highlighted during the two brothers' meeting with Clemenza, Tom, and Tessio as the five discuss how to handle Soloso's request to discuss a truce. Sonny unsurprisingly raises his voice at the idea of Soloso's proposition, pacing the room aggressively and yelling at those who suggest hearing Soloso out. "No more meetings, no more discussions, no more Soloso tricks," Sonny yells, towering over Tom. "Do me a favor, Tom, no more advice on how to patch things up. Just help me win." Michael, on the other hand, sits stoically on a plush chair, watching the scene unfold. After a brief moment of silence, Michael enters into the conversation. "We can't wait," he says calmly, remaining seated. "I don't care what Soloso says about a deal. He's going to kill Pop. That's it." Interestingly, Sonny and Michael want the same thing. They both think it's wiser to strike now rather than give Soloso the benefit of the doubt. This is indicative of their potential to both be sound leaders. However, what Sonny articulates via artless aggression, Michael expresses in a methodical plan of action. "They want to have a meeting with me, right? Let's set the meeting," Michael says as he goes on to detail how they will orchestrate the ambush and dodge any possible retaliation. We might see Vito and Michael as self-made men or self-made dons, though they take different routes to the same destination. While Vito built the institution of the Corleone family from the ground up, Michael comes of age over the course of film and makes himself into a man by virtue of avenging an attempt on his father's life. We later see that Michael successfully carries out the plan for the Corleone family, unflinchingly putting bullets in Soloso and Captain McCluskey's heads and ending the threat to his father's life. Insofar as Vito possesses a calculated gentleness and Sonny does not, Michael learns from their shortcomings to realize a calculated ruthlessness. He is a man who does not strike unless it is absolutely necessary, but does not hesitate to get his hands dirty when he must. Michael's newfound, calculated ruthlessness is powerfully evoked in the movie's bloody climax, in which the camera cuts between the baptism of his godson and the assassinations of his rivals. But Michael's metamorphosis is even more strikingly dramatized in a scene soon after, when Michael confronts Carlo about his complicity in Sonny's murder. "Sit down," he tells Carlo as he pulls up a chair and takes a seat next to him. He pats Carlo on the shoulder and calmly reassures him. "Don't be afraid. Do you think I'd make my sister a widow?" Michael tells Carlo that he will have to leave for Las Vegas and hands him a plane ticket. "Only don't tell me you're innocent because it insults my intelligence." "Now who approached you?" Michael asks. When Carlo finally admits to his involvement, Michael directs him to a car that is supposed to take him to an airport. Clemenza, sitting in the back seat, garrotes Carlo to his death as Michael watches from the outside. For all the talk that we hear of Vito taking care of business toward the beginning of the film, we never once see him personally enact violence or be in the vicinity of it. Michael, on the other hand, both tactfully extracts a confession and also watches his brother-in-law lose his life at his own order, without so much as a flinch. The film establishes Michael's masculinity relationally through the men that came before him. He learns from his father's distaste for violence and his brother's carelessness to become a true, successful capo da capi of the Corleone family. Michael's consolidation of power proves to be a fitting end to the first installment of the Godfather trilogy, which is primarily interested in charting the jostle for power between and within families to establish a new socio-political hierarchy within the organized crime circuit in the mid-1940s America. In the post-war context, men grappled with how to express their masculinity and assert their dominance outside the battlefield. The film encapsulates this struggle by moving through two different modes of masculinity, through Vito and Sonny, before settling on the only viable option in Michael, whose calculated ruthlessness secures the survival and prosperity of the family. The other dons have been vanquished, and there's no character within the family who might take its helm. The film underscores how Fredo's feebleness and lack of intelligence and Tom's non-Sicilian heritage effectively take them out of consideration for the leadership of the family, while the women of the film are shut out from that form of power entirely. Michael stands alone, unchallenged, his character having successfully resolved the film's complex exploration of the relationship between gender and power in the post-war era. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, make sure to subscribe for more. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, make sure to subscribe for more.